Thank you. Presentation. Thank you. Mrs. Laura Jean-Pierre Noel to do the eulogy. Today I have been tasked with the heart-wrenching task of eulogizing our beloved departed Wenceslaus Aimable. Though it would be impossible to describe his larger-than-life persona in a few words, I do feel the need to try and say something about him that will resonate with all of us for the rest of our lives. As I said earlier, Wenceslaus Aimable was my uncle. Uncle Winnie was born on September 29, 1955, in Dudu Bands at Labury, to Titus Carrasco and Agnes Aimable, both deceased. He was the first and only son of his parents, but had a maternal younger brother, Thomas Momos Aimable. He had two protective older sisters, one of which is my beautiful mom, Loretta Nono Japierre, and the other, the eldest and current matriarch of our family, Florence Glory Sis Aimable. He had one lovely younger sister, Margaret Margot Nicholas. He had a good childhood. And even though my grandparents were not rich, their home was filled with love. They selected his godparents thoughtfully. Officially, his godfather was deceased Mr. Gabriel Gabu Japanel. Unofficially, deceased Uncle Man Carrasco was his godfather. Those of you who knew Uncle Man knew he was a man of principle. Uncle Man declined godfathership because he didn't approve of Daddy Titus having any more children with Granny out of wedlock. He was not going to be a party to that. Uncle Winnie's godmother was deceased Josephine Shifi Carrasco, Uncle Man's wife, who didn't share her husband's principle. So you see, from birth, Uncle was surrounded by strong women. My Uncle Winnie and his sisters often told me how their parents, especially their mom, always made sure they had all the things they needed. Moreover, my grandparents understood the value of family togetherness and did their best to encourage and see to it that all their children were close to each other. They were so close that when Granny left Uncle Winnie in the village for school with his great-grand-aunt, Auntie Momo Louis, he would often stand by the road crying and pining until one day his unofficial godfather, Uncle Man, picked him up on his horse and brought him back to Dudu. What a conundrum. Granny didn't know what to do. To which an uncontrite Uncle Man responded, "I couldn't leave him there." This is just an example of the closeness that Uncle shared with his sisters, a trait that he continued in his adult life. He loved all his nieces and nephews like they were his own, even before he had children, his own children. He was blessed with three daughters, the eldest of whom, Celine, predeceased him. His wife, Auntie May, bore him twin daughters, Vern and Van, who, even for twins, are extremely close, testament to their father's upbringing. Uncle so loved his children that when his daughter Vern was getting married, he confided to me with tears in his eyes that had he built an apartment beneath his family home, today his daughter would not be leaving him. Not that he minded her getting married, he minded her not living in his house. I had to remind him that she's not leaving him per se, and that he's gaining a son. It was of no consolation. He was so used to providing for, protecting, and loving his children that the thought of another man being tasked to do just that was just too much. My uncle was also a dedicated husband to his beautiful wife, Auntie Marilyn. Their relationship seemed so perfect, and they made marriage look so effortless, even though their union had lasted 37 years. They would do everything together, including shopping, cooking, eating, laundry, administering her meds, and raising their beautiful daughters, and later their grandchildren. They were best friends, lovers, lifelong companions. Uncle was a handsome man, which transcended even that infernal beard. Oh, that beard that all of us nieces and nephews were terrified of. He loved giving us hugs and kisses just so that he could press his beard to our tender cheeks and laugh as we squealed to get away from his reach. Being that he had twins, he was used to carrying them together. It was nothing for him to carry my two younger sisters, Leanne and Lanya, together so that neither one escaped the dreaded beard. He and Auntie May really looked good together. Whenever you took the time to observe them, I would quickly remind myself that even in today's world, it is still possible to have a beautiful and lasting marriage. Uncle Winnie was a jack of all trades. He could fix anything, and he hated knowing that something was not working right, particularly a vehicle. In his early days, he would buy old cars, restore them, and resell them. My cousin Irene will testify that if you knew your car had an issue, do not give Uncle Winnie a ride, because he would spend the entire ride trying to decipher the source of the sound. Uncle started working his early life with deceased Mr. Joe Emanuel as a gas station attendant at Esso Gas Station in Viewfort. The stories he could tell about his older sisters, Glory and Nono, working at that gas station. When Mr. Joe, in an attempt to keep his sanity, sent my mom away to work at Manumatics, Uncle left to join her there a few years later as a driver, family dynamics at work. He eventually left Manumatics to become a taxi driver with Southern Taxi Association, which he remained bonded to until his death. He was an avid lover of music. As such, he owned hi-fi Scorpio DJs, along with his brother-in-law Nigel Nicholas and his friends Spencer Emmanuel and Mervyn Gustave. His faithful followers included deceased Sholup and Coffee. Uncle believed in love and not war. Scorpio DJs eventually broke up, fun fact, because of a fight at one of the sessions which they were playing at. Uncle didn't jump into the fray, but heeded his mother's warnings and left. As such, he was considered a coward by one of his friends, and thus the end of Scorpio DJs. He loved to dance. No party would be swinging if Uncle wasn't on the dance floor dancing up a storm. Just 4 months ago at my wedding, he was tearing up the place. We shared a dance together, and he said to me, "Lolly, Uncle still got the moves. Still got the moves, you know. Music la bon." My uncle was proud of his family and never missed an opportunity to tell each one of us how proud he was of us. I remember the first time he told me he was proud of my husband's accomplishments as a young man when so many of our young men were turning to crime and drugs. To say that melted my heart is truly an understatement. My uncle also had a sense of humor, and there was never a dull moment with him. He would make some of the silliest jokes that forced you to laugh or even smile, even though some of the jokes were about him, he was a subject of him. I mean, I could go on, time does not permit me, except one joke. I will share one joke. One day, as a little boy, he was playing with a knife, and he inadvertently threw the knife down a precipice. His sister, Glory, told him that he had to go down the precipice the same way the knife went to get that knife back. The joke was on her that day, though, because before she could even finish issuing that directive, Uncle had scuttled his little butt through the hedges, down the cliff to get the knife. Yep, he was that obedient. Few other jokes, but we will pass for now. Although my uncle had his own children, he showed lots of love to me, my siblings, and cousins. Plum season would often find him under the plum tree at Granny, picking plums with my sisters. He always ensured he was there to pick up his nieces, Lorraine, Irene, and Lisa from the airport when they came down for summer vacations. He would make it his duty to do the mandatory sulfur springs around the island and trips to Dudu with us when they visited. Those were the days. Showing up was Uncle's hallmark. Whether it was waiting for Mr. Carl to get off work at the power plant, or to ensure he got home safely to his family, or to offer an unsolicited ride to his friend Spencer, even though they were going in opposite directions, or to ensure his daughter's friends got home safely after class, Uncle always showed up. When his sisters started having grandchildren, he loved them all as if they were his own. But when he started having grandchildren of his own, he was quick to tell my mom how she cannot cut style on him anymore. But oh, how we love those grandchildren, and oh, how they love their dada. Broken toys, ribbons to cut, pictures to draw, meals to prepare, taking the grands to church or school on time, those and more were his to attend to. Uncle Winnie also loved socializing with people. He was such a selfless man who touched so many lives. At his passing, young, old, not so young, yet not quite old, was stunned at the news. Tears were shed in unusual quarters, for he was such a pleasant man, always eager to help. Whether it was going out of his way to assist a friend or a vote of confidence in a young man, he was truly loved. He was attentive and would listen to anyone's problems and offer them solutions. Fortunately, he was remarkably filled with wisdom, so his wife, siblings, colleagues, and friends could always count on him. Unfortunately, death suddenly snatched him from us November 8th, 2022. Everything still feels like a nightmare to us. And I vividly remember when my sister called me to say he didn't make it. I had barely gotten used to him being at the hospital. It was so heartbreaking that many of us never got the opportunity to tell him goodbye. Even though we enjoyed some beautiful moments, we still feel like we didn't tell him how much we loved him enough. Uncle Winnie will forever remain an award-winning uncle, and I will always remember him as the bearded uncle, full of life and energy. He might be gone, but his legacy lives on in the many lives he affected, especially his grandchildren. It's unfortunate he won't be here to see Amari and Gracie walk down the aisle or see Makai and Mavanyo become upstanding gentlemen. But I know, as I have a day to join him in his celestial home, that they will make him proud wherever they go and whatever they do. I have a ton of sweet memories about him, and I could go on telling his tales for days. But I know that would only cover an ounce of his life, and it would still be an imperfect explanation of someone we all loved so much. I know that even though he's gone, he is still there with us, in the leaves of the trees that he planted, in the fruits that bloom in full swing in the season, in the birds that he loved so much, in the sounds of his favorite songs. I hope to live life the best I can, following his principles and teachings that will be treasured by many generations in our family to come. Auntie May, Vern, Van, and all of our family, love is kind and patient. Love does not envy or boast. It's not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 4 to 8 and verse 13. If this Bible verse needed an ambassador, it would be my Uncle Winnie. Thank you all for taking the time to pay your condolences to our beloved departed soul. May you rest in peace.
At this time, the Couples for Christ members will do a short prayer and then we will commence. Please stand.
Good afternoon, brothers and sisters. Good afternoon. Welcome to the funeral service of our brother. Wenceslaus, Aimable. And as we gather to celebrate his life and death, we first of all ask God to be merciful towards him as we thank him for his life, for his family, his wife, family and extended family and friends. We pray for consolation and strength during this period of grief and sorrow. And for ourselves, remembering death can be at the door, can happen at any moment. We pray asking God to protect us from uneventual or unprovided death. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace and peace of God our Father, the love of his Son Jesus, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Praise be God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies, and the God of all consolation, who comforts us from all our afflictions, and thus enables us to comfort those who are in trouble with the same consolation we have received from him. Blessed be God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. I bless the body of our brother Wenceslaus with this holy water, which recalls his baptism, of which St. Paul writes, all of us were baptized into Christ Jesus, were baptized into his death. By baptism into his death, we are buried together with him, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with him by likeness to his death, so shall we be united with him by likeness to his resurrection. The white cloth, the white pall, symbolism of what happened at the baptism of our brother when he was baptized and received the gift of the Holy Spirit, is godparents and parents were asked to help him to bring that new life unstained into the everlasting life of heaven. And our prayer today is, when Wenceslaus, on the day of baptism, he put on Christ, on the day of his coming, may he be clothed in glory.
Let us join in the entrance hymn, Canticle of the Sun.
Thank you. us pray. Lord, as we mourn the sudden death of our brother Wenceslaus, show us the immense power of your goodness and strengthen our belief that he has entered into your presence. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Please be seated. Can the two readers come up? The first reading is from the Book of Wisdom, chapter 3, verse 1 to 9. He accepted them as a holocaust.
The souls of the virtuous are in the hands of God. No torment shall ever touch them. In the eyes of the universe, they did appear to die. Their going looked like a disaster. They're leaving us like an annihilation. But they are in peace. If they experience punishment as men see it, their hope was rich with immortality. Slight was their affliction. Great will their blessings be. God has put them to the test and proved them worthy to be with him. He has tested them like gold in a furnace and accepted them as a holocaust. But when the time comes for his visitation, they will shine out. As sparks run through the stubble, so will they. They shall judge nations, rule over peoples. I'm sorry, I've read the wrong one. I'll do this one. Okay. And the Lord will be their king forever. They who trust in him will understand the truth. For they are faithful with life, for those who are faithful will live with him in love, for grace and mercy await those who he has chosen. The word of the Lord.
In response to the reading, we sing, "The Lord is my shepherd, he lives." The second reading is from the first letter of St. Paul to the Thessalonians, chapter 4, verse 13 to 18. We shall stay with the Lord forever.
We want you to be quite certain, brothers, about those who have died, to make sure that you do not grieve about them like the other people who have no hope. We believe that Jesus died and rose again, and that it will be the same for those who have died in Jesus. God will bring them with him. We can tell you this from the Lord's own teaching, that any of us who are left alive until the Lord's coming will not have any advantage over those who have died. At the trumpet of God, the voice of the archangel will call out the command, and the Lord himself will come down from heaven. Those who have died in Christ will be the first to rise, and then those of us who are still alive will be taken up in the clouds together with them to meet the Lord in the air. So we shall stay with the Lord forever. With such thoughts as these, you should comfort one another. This is the word of the Lord.
Please stand to acclaim the gospel. Come, you whom my Father has blessed, says the Lord. Take for your heritage the kingdom prepared for you since the foundation of the world.
From the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Chapter 5, from verses 1 to 12. Seeing the crowds, Jesus went up the hill. There he sat down and was joined by his disciples. Then he began to speak. This is what he taught them. How happy are the poor in spirit. Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Happy the gentle. They shall have the earth for their heritage. Happy those who mourn. They shall be comforted. Happy those who hunger and thirst for what is right. They shall be satisfied. Happy the merciful. They shall have mercy shown towards them. Happy the pure in heart. They shall see God. Happy the peacemakers. They shall be called sons of God. Happy those who are persecuted in the cause of right. Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Happy are you when people abuse you and persecute you and speak all kinds of calumny against you on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward in heaven will be great. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
on behalf of myself, Father Goodman, parish staff, and the entire parish community, of the purification of the Blessed Virgin Mary, extend our deepest love, support, and encouragement to the wife of our brother, Mary Lynn, children, grandchildren, extended family, friends, and dear ones. Death is never an easy challenge to accept. But there are many things we learn from death. There was this couple who had been married for 70 years. They were both in the 90s. And for a long time they were discussing how would they live without each other. And they continued to encourage each other. The wife said to the husband, if I die before you, you have to learn to live without me. And the husband said to his wife, if I die before you, you have to learn to live without me. The husband died first. His death hit home for the wife. And the first fundamental question she asked herself was, how will I live without my husband? The second question she eventually was able to ask herself is, I have to live without him. I have to learn to live without him, and I have to live without him. So she began developing a strategy to live without her husband. And the first thing she did was to go through their life's journey in photos. They had several albums with key events of their personal life, family life, celebrations of one form or the other. And what hit home the most for her was when her mother and father died. She remembered her father saying to them, my children, I have done everything with the help of mommy to do right. There is nothing I need to tell you, you do not know. There is nothing about life in terms of responsibility you have not learned from me and your mother. In the memoirs of your life, my life, mommy's life, live life as you learned it. That stood in the heart of his wife, the true meaning of experience, practical experience of living together, the memoirs of realizing the management of her life, but most importantly, to remember, love was the key word. So in the same way, memories do not die, love never dies. And she said to herself, I will live my life as if my husband was still alive, to love as I always did our children, the events we celebrate after his death, the places we go, the things that are dear to us, and most importantly, our love of God and the love of the things we love. We cannot, even for a moment of our life, bring one back to life. But we have the power of living to the full after death. Hence, the reason why the constant struggle of the Christian is to ask the fundamental question, what is most important in my life? How do I treasure the most important thing in my life? And how will I continue to manage the most important thing in my life? From the eulogy given today about our brother, two things were very outstanding: his family life and his relationship with those he loved outside his family. I believe, brothers and sisters, as we delve into today's scripture readings, beginning from the second reading, one thing stands out. St. Paul tells us today, we can tell you with this from the Lord's own teaching, that any of us who are left alive until the Lord's coming will not have any advantage over those who have died. Live life today in the best way you can. If you live to see tomorrow, even better, and the day after, even better. Those who have gone before us and those who are alive now are at no advantage over the other. The only advantage there can be, if there is any, has to do with the quality of our lives, how we lived. The witness or the example and the things that matter or matter the most in our life. For our brother Wenceslaus, his family, friendships and dear ones was the most important after God. His whole life was surrounded with love. Marilyn, today and many days ahead, you'll be facing that battle of having to live without your husband. His physical presence will not be there, but the memoirs, the memory of a man, your lover, the dearest and most important to you for all of these years, 27 years of marriage. God has blessed you with the best. You cherish him for all of these years. I believe the experience of his death calls you to realize how much we belong to each other and how much we are called, even in the absence of the other in marriage, to live as we always live. In addition to that, God surrounds you with your children and grandchildren, your joy and your pride. So God has not taken everything away. He has left the prized gift for you, the gift of your children and grandchildren. That is why in marriage, God blesses us with children, so that children expands the ocean of love and goodness, which is really and truly the beauty of life. And so today we can say, in essence, God has taken the love of your life away, but has surrounded your life with so many persons of love. So those who have died and those who are alive do not have any advantage over the other. The quality of our life and the way we choose to continue to live today, tomorrow, or how long we live is the most important. And most importantly too, when we remember people who have died and the good they have done, especially for us, or how they have influenced our lives, demonstrates for us how good it is when people can live well and touch our lives by the way they live. As against saying, I really do not care much about this guy or this person because there was nothing really to attract me or to help change my life. As we delved into this gospel reading, Jesus found himself his first public sermon in the presence of a huge crowd, confronted with persons from all walks of life, the rich, the poor, the sick, the mournful, people who did not know the right hand from the left hand because of their unique challenges. And his key points in the Beatitudes, the eight Beatitudes mentioned in today's gospel reading, is how happy or how blessed are the poor in spirit. Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Literally, the poor in spirit are not those who are materially poor, but those who are poor in terms of their uselessness or non-functional without God. Those who recognize the need for the total dependency on God. Those who recognize without God, life will never be the same. Those who recognize that life begins with God and life ends with God. God is the essence of life. Because he was saying to the crowds, in essence, no matter where you are at in your life, no matter what you are lacking, no matter your grief, your sorrow, your pain, if you entrust your life to me because of your poverty or your helplessness or your need, I will accompany you. I will journey with you, provide, guide, direct, and ensure that you are secure. The God we believe in and the God we put our trust in is a God who has a deep sense of humor and a God who understands human need. And so, the poor in spirit, as you face at this time of grief and mourning, through the fact that it is impossible for Wenceslaus to come back to life, but at the same time to recognize the goodness of his life, encourages us to realize in our helplessness, there is a God surrounding, guiding, and empowering our lives. What a difference it makes to believe that God understands human needs. As we move into today's gospel reading, the souls of the booty were in the hands of God. No torment shall ever touch them. In the eyes of the unwise, they seem to die. They're living like an annihilation, but they are in peace. If they experience punishment, as others see, slight will their troubles be. God has put them to the test and found them worthy to be with him. That is the key point of this reading. God has put them to the test and found them worthy to be with him. Wenceslaus have gone through his tests. 67 years of testing. His test is over. We are still in the process of managing ours in a world that is aggressive and difficult. What is there to learn from Wenceslaus' life that can inspire us to continue to persevere during this time of testing in his life? I believe it is very simple. To realize our uniqueness and the opportunities God gives to us. To choose good and to manage life in a responsible way. In summarizing today's message, therefore, three words remain important. Responsibility, trust, and endurance. The responsibility or responsibilities God has given to us in his life. Wenceslaus managed it through his family, his friendships, his presence, his love, his care. Endurance, he endured, we are called not to allow the trials of this life to overpower us. Finally, the hope we have today in a resurrected Jesus calls us to realize there is a life more important beyond death, and that is to be with the Lord forever. He put him to the test and found him worthy to be with him. Let us thank God for his life. Thank God for the challenges he faced in his life and being able to stand out and endure many temptations and trials. And in the process, was able to leave behind for us a way of managing without him by love, through love, recalling the memoirs of his life in our memory and trying to live as he lived, managing and taking responsibility for our lives. May God, who has called Wenceslaus back to himself, be merciful in his judgment towards him and teach us in our own human frailties to be strong, to endure, and by being poor in spirit, to allow God to guide us in good times, in bad times, in difficulties, and in the moments of decision in our lives. Amen.
Please stand.
Brothers and sisters, Jesus Christ is risen from the dead and sits at the right hand of the Father, where he intercedes for his church, confident that God hears the voices of those who trust in the Lord Jesus. We join our prayers to his.
For our deceased brother Wenceslaus, who in baptism was given the pledge of eternal life, that the Lord will be merciful in his judgment towards him and grant him pardon and the forgiveness of his sins and admit him in the company of the saints. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the family and the friends of our brother Wenceslaus, that they may be consoled in their grief and sorrow by the Lord,
who wept at the death of his friend Lazarus. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our deceased relatives and friends, and for all who have helped them, that God will reward them with his goodness, blessing them with renewed vigor, strength, and courage to serve him faithfully and those entrusted to their care. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick, suffering, dying, and others in desperate need, that God will accompany them in their pain and their suffering. May they come to experience the love and care of Jesus through the love and presence of persons who can listen, understand, and minister Christ's love and strength to them. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For peace, that God may calm the storms of violence and the bloodshed and bring the human family to calm and cooperation. May there be greater efforts at resolving conflicts through dialogue and meaningful negotiations. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. The family and friends of our brother seek comfort and consolation, heal their pain, and dispel the darkness and doubt that comes from grief. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
We are assembled here in faith and confidence to pray for our brother Wenceslaus, strengthen our hope so that we may live in the expectation of your son's coming. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Please take a moment in silence to add your own intentions. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Lord God, giver of peace and healer of souls, hear the prayers of the Redeemer Jesus Christ and the voices of your people whose lives were purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ and grant them a place in your kingdom where you live and reign forever and ever.
Amen. Please be seated. During this time, we will have a collection. We sing, "It Is Well With My Soul."
Thank you.
sisters, please stand as you prepare for the reception of Holy Communion. The Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ. Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but upon the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever." Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace. Of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb.
communion, we sing Table of Grace. Those of you coming up to receive communion, the ushers will be available to sanitize you, or if you have your own personal sanitized, do so. Thank you.
Let us pray.
Please stand.
Lord Jesus Christ, Lord God, your Son Jesus Christ gave us the sacrament of his body and blood to guide us on our pilgrim way to your kingdom. May our brother Wenceslaus, who share in the Eucharist, come to the banquet of life Christ has prepared for us. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Please be seated. During this time, we have the signing of the register. The witnesses are Marilyn Aimable, Vern Aimable, Van Aimable, and Florence Aimable. And we will meditate on the words of the song, No More Nights.
Brothers and sisters, please stand for the final commendation. Trusting in God, we have prayed together for our brother Wenceslaus, and now we come to the last farewell. There is sadness in parting, but we take comfort in the hope that one day we'll see Wenceslaus again and enjoy his friendship. Although this congregation will disperse in sorrow, the love and mercy of God will continue to accompany us each day until we gather again in the joy of his kingdom. Therefore, let us console one another in the love and joy of Jesus Christ.
During the final commendation, we sing All I Ask of You.
Your response to the litany: receive his soul and present him to God the Most High. Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High. Saints of God, come to his aid. Hasten to meet him, angels of the Lord.
Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High.
May Christ who called you take you to himself. May the angels lead you to the side of Abraham. Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him.
Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High.
Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother Wenceslaus in the sure and soothing hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon him in this life.
for the assurance to us of your goodness, and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn towards us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise, your servant, and help us who mourn to comfort one another with the assurances of faith, hope, and love, until we all meet with Christ and are with you and our brother forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord. In peace, let us take our brother to his final place of rest. May the angels lead him to paradise. May the voices of us welcome him on your way, and lead him to the holy city, and then you and his children to Jerusalem. Our brother will lead him to rest, and ascend him to you.
On behalf of our officiating and parish priest, Father Athanas, we, the Lambrin community, would like to extend our sincere condolences to Miss Marilyn and the entire Aimable family. We will miss him dearly, especially on our Sunday masses, but our love and prayers are